Well, hi everyone. My name is Steve Layson. I'm part of the ministry team here at Gerringong Anglican Church. I want to say thank you so much for joining us. It's great to have you with us. We've been looking in recent weeks at the people that you meet at the very beginning of the Bible in the book of Genesis. We've looked at the Creator and the ones He created. And last week, we saw how those created ones rejected God. They reached out, took the fruit, and disobeyed God. And so were removed from His presence. Today we're skipping forward a couple of chapters to Genesis chapter 6. But in the meantime, we've seen actually things begin to unravel. Adam and Eve took and ate the fruit that God told them not to eat. But their son, Cain, took things a step much further. He actually reached out and killed his brother. But also we've seen the pride of humanity really growing as well. In chapter 4, we meet a guy by the name of Lamech. And this is how he boasts. He said, if Cain is avenged seven times, then Lamech is avenged 77 times. In other words, if God says He will bring down the heads of those who hurt Cain, what they have done, then Lamech says, well, if that's what God can do, I can do so much more. 77 times. I'm so strong. I'm so powerful. It's quite a contrast, isn't it, to Jesus, we should forgive 77 times. But the pride of humanity is growing. The sin of humanity is growing. And today, we're going to be looking at one of the most familiar stories in the whole of the Bible, the story of Noah and the flood. And we're going to see the implication of sin on our lives, but also the existence of God's grace and what an impact that can have on our lives. But before we begin our service, will you join with me as we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this beautiful world we live in. We recognise that this world is also broken. We've experienced the pain and the suffering that has come. Lord, we pray that today You will give us a fresh understanding of how we stand in relation to You and each other. And that, Lord, we would understand Your grace and Your mercy that is available to all people. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's begin our service by singing together. Let's join in singing the song, Rejoice. Thank you.
been in isolation?
Oh, way too many. I don't even know.
So you don't know the answers?
No.
Well, I don't have the answers. But you know who does have the answers? Siri. Hey Siri, how many days have we been in isolation?
Here's what I found.
Okay, so
did she say?
Siri doesn't have answers. She just refers to other people's answers. Sends us to the web. Siri, she doesn't have it all. She doesn't have the knowledge. She needs other people's knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
But you know who's got all the knowledge?
God! So Siri doesn't know all the answers, but God does. I wonder if there's any ISO stories in the Bible.
Well, we have been looking at Genesis, so let's see. Aha! Noah!
Today in God's big picture, we're going to be looking at Noah.
Like Noah, we have had to learn just how difficult it is to distance ourselves from people and to isolate ourselves when we're told and we know that it's the right thing to do. It can still be a challenge.
Yeah. At least we didn't have to do it with stinky animals.
I did.
Okay.
Henry. Now we're going to check out Noah's story with a great video from the Gospel Project.
Adam and Eve had children and grandchildren. Soon there were many people in the world. Every one of them did just what Adam and Eve had done. They made bad choices. They did not choose to do what God said. God saw that the people did mean things and thought bad thoughts. God was very sad. God is holy and perfect. He was sorry he had made all the people who chose to sin against him. God decided to send a big flood to clean up the world. Everyone would die in the flood, but God showed favor to a man named Noah. Noah was a righteous man, and God told Noah to build an ark, a really big boat. God told Noah about his plan to send the flood. In the ark, Noah's family and many kinds of birds and animals that lived on the earth would be safe from the flood. Noah did what God said. He began to build the ark just like God told him to build it. Noah worked for many years until the ark was finished. Then he filled it with food for his family and for the animals, just as God had told him. Every kind of animal came to the ark, males and females. Rain began to fall, so Noah, his family, and the animals went into the ark. God closed the door of the ark, and Noah and his family were safe inside. The rain came for 40 days and 40 nights. Water covered all the earth, even the highest mountains. The ark floated on the water, and everyone inside the ark was safe. Finally, the rain stopped, but the water was still very deep. God sent a wind, and the water went down. The ark landed on a mountaintop, and everyone in the ark waited for the earth to dry out. Then, God told Noah to bring his family and all the animals out of the ark. Noah gave an offering to thank God. God had saved Noah, his family, and the animals from the flood. God told Noah's family to spread out and live in different places, to have children, and to take care of the world. God promised Noah that he would never again send a flood to cover the whole earth. God put a rainbow in the clouds to be a reminder of his promise. God sent a flood to punish the world for sin, but God rescued Noah and his family. Later, there was an even greater rescue. Jesus came to save people from sin. If we trust in Jesus, he saves us from the punishment of our sin.
Thank you. That was a great reminder of Noah's story. Your heart can always determine how you act.
And what you believe and feel about God will shape how you respond to Him.
I wonder how Noah postured himself before God.
What do you mean by posture?
I'll show you what I mean by posture.
Lily, don't. Please.
Too late, too late, too late. Welcome to Lily's posture class. First off, you're going to be a pretty princess and walk with a book on your head. So that didn't quite work out, but I'm still amazing. Alright, next thing.
Really, Lily? I don't think that's what it means. That's not... It's about posture to God, not falling.
This is what I mean by posture. Posture one. Did Noah have his back turned to God, like he didn't want to hear him?
Like this?
Yeah, like that. Or was it more like posture two? Was it like a big fist pump at him because he was angry? Is that what Noah did?
God!
Yeah. Did Noah do that? Or was he more like posture three? Was he studying God's word? Or was he more like posture four, praying and talking to God?
What do you reckon Noah's posture was to God?
I don't know. Why don't we take a quick pause and discuss it?
What do you reckon Noah's kid's posture was to God?
And finally, while we've been in isolation, what's our posture to God been? Have we been ignoring Him with our backs turned? Or have we been shaking our fists at Him in anger? Have we been studying and questioning Him? Or have we been praying to Him and talking to Him? Because
Proverbs 4 verse 23 says, "Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it." Sorry guys, but Family Feast has been pushed back another week due to COVID.
That's really fun.
What am I doing?
And remember to send Kaz your colouring in so that you can vote for who you want to get waterbombed. So far, Kaz is winning. And we need more votes for Kaz because it's getting a little close to me and I don't really want to get waterbombed. So,
or
you can vote for Lily.
No, we make Am get waterbombed, guys. Make
no, please, please.
Am.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, no, we need...
Put your hands backwards. It's like baby arms.
What?
See, I look like I have really tiny arms now.
You're pissed at me you're recording this.
But yeah.
Oh, hi, my name's Irene Klingon. I attend the 10 o'clock service. And I'm going to be reading Genesis 6, 9 to 22. This is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. So God said to Noah, "I am going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy them and the earth. So make yourself an ark of cypress, wood, make rooms in it and coat it with pitch inside and out. This is how you are to build it. The ark is to be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide and 30 cubits high. Make a roof for it, leaving below the roof an opening 1 cubit high all around. Put a door in the side of the ark and make lower, middle and upper decks. I'm going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens, every creature that has the breath of life in it. Everything on earth will perish, but I will establish my covenant with you, and you will enter the ark, you and your sons, and your wife, and your sons' wives with you. You are to bring into the ark two all living creatures, male and female, to keep them alive with you. Two of every kind of bird, of every kind of animal, and of every kind of creature that moves along the ground will come to you to be kept alive. You are to take every kind of food that is to be eaten and store it away as food for you and for them. Noah did everything just as God commanded him. This is the word of the Lord.
Hi, I'm Brendan. I go to the 10 a.m. service. This is my fifth attempt at trying to read this without stuffing up, so here we go. Then God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. The fear of dread of you will fall upon all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air, upon every creature that moves along the ground and upon all the fish of the sea. They are given into your hands. Everything that lives and moves will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now give you everything. But you must not eat meat that has its lifeblood still in it. And for your lifeblood, I will surely demand an accounting. I will demand an accounting from every animal and from each man too. I'll demand an accounting for the life of his fellow man. Whoever sheds the blood of a man, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of God has God made man. And for you, be fruitful and increase in number. Multiply on the earth and increase upon it." Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "I now establish my covenant with you, with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be cut off by the waters of the flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth." And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant I am making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all life. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth." So God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant I have established between me and all life on the earth."
Yes. Well, hi there. My name is John, and I'm one of the ministers here at Gerringong Anglican Church. It's good to be with you. Now, today, we're hearing about Noah. I'm sure that Noah is one of the stories in the Bible, one of the characters in the Bible that you know lots about. It's a very familiar story. Perhaps you first heard it at Sunday school not so long ago, or many years ago, or maybe it was scripture, or wherever it was. You've probably heard this story before. It's one of the classics in children's Bibles, in animations. I think most people have heard of Noah and Noah's Ark and the flood and all those sorts of things. And most of the time when people talk about this story, it's all about the animals going in two by two. And a lot of illustrations and pictures have all these different animals all lined up in their various pairs. It may surprise you to learn that back at the time it was first written, it was already a very familiar story, because lots of different cultures around the Israelite culture also had stories of a great flood that wiped out much, if not all, of humanity, save for one special person or a couple of special people who were spared. And sometimes the animals were spared as well, other times they weren't. But it was a very familiar story back then. So our challenge today is to think about what this very familiar story might actually have to say to us today, and what possible relevance it might have for us today. Now, maybe you think not much at all, but it's very easy to find common links, even in these familiar stories, even in familiar stories from the very start of that ancient book, the Bible. As we get into our series, or continue on in our series in Genesis, back to the beginning, looking at the different characters we encounter along the way, it's not hard to find common links. For example, you might have already heard in the background that as I speak, it's raining. It's raining lots today. And even though it's only been raining for one day, it already feels like it's been raining forever and ever. And there's more to come tomorrow. In fact, today as I was down the street shopping, someone made jokes to me about Noah and the flood, not knowing I was actually going to be preaching on this topic. So it kind of, you know, it suits where we're at right now. But also, recently, we've all experienced weeks and weeks of isolation inside with our families and our pets. That sound familiar to the story of Noah? And of course, in recent times, there have been many, many cruise ships drifting around at sea for weeks on end, waiting to see if there's anywhere they can land. Lots of common links between that old familiar story and today. But of course, apart from those coincidental similarities with the events of the story of Noah, this account in Genesis has a great deal to teach us today. And it's not just about the animals. I just want to start by highlighting a couple of things. First of all, I don't know if you noticed as we heard those Bible passages read, and if you've read through the bit in between the two, because they're the start and finish of this Noah story, I don't know if you noticed, this was actually God pressing reset on creation. Did you notice the similarities? Particularly when God was blessing Noah and his sons. Did you notice chapter 9, verses 1 and following, that God says to them, be fruitful and increase in number, filling the earth. And he gives them, you know, dominion over the creatures of the earth. And he talks about how they've been created in the image of God. These are all things we heard about during the creation story. And so this reset on creation reaffirms the created order with humanity over the rest of creation, reaffirms this idea of humanity being created in the image of God, reaffirms the stewardship that we have over creation, reaffirms this command to go forth and multiply throughout the earth. These are very important principles that are being re-established here at this point in the story, but also kind of reset as the way things had been going since Adam and Eve got kicked out of the garden have kind of, you know, come to a head with the sinfulness of the world, and God's kind of saying, I'm going to start again. This is creation Mark 2. Now, this account was also an answer to those other stories of a flood that I mentioned were out there in, you know, Babylonian stories or the Akkadian stories, other Sumerian stories of a flood with various heroes who might have been involved. This is those same stories told from the perspective of those who believe in the one God of the Bible and kind of answering their claims about how it all worked. And if you ever, you know, have the time or inclination to compare these ancient stories, you'll find that the theological claims that are being made here are in line with the start of Genesis and kind of once again position God as a God of relationship and purpose and power and a God who wants to be in relationship with the humans he has created. The other stories say very different things about their gods and their connection with people, their care for people. It's a very different story, even though the events seem very similar. So this account is answering those. In the same way we saw the creation accounts, we're answering other common creation accounts. We've got to remember this part of Genesis in particular is making very clear theological claims about who God is and how he relates to the world and to us. and they're wonderful truths that we learn about God. You see, from what we see in this story of Noah and the ark and the flood are some very clear truths. We see what it looks like to be a righteous person in the world, in the person of Noah. Now, Noah isn't perfect, but he is faithful and obedient. He trusts in the promises of God, and he obeys what God tells him to do. And that's a wonderful role model for all of us to follow. The other thing we notice is that this reset on creation actually assumes that there is ongoing sin. See, in the bit we've skipped over since last week in Genesis 3, in chapters 4 and 5, we see that the sin that has entered the world through Adam and Eve and their rebellion against God continues down the generations. First of all, the story of Cain and Abel and the murder that takes place there, but in subsequent generations as well, building and building until, as we see here in Genesis 6, the earth is corrupt in God's sight, full of violence. And so that sin has spread throughout. And even though God sets, you know, kind of presses reset on creation with the flood and starts again with Noah and his family, there is still sin in the picture. If you continue on in chapter 9 after where our reading picked up, our reading finished, you see that there is sin going on with Noah's son, Ham, and possibly his grandson, Canaan, as well. And there's the consequence of sin ongoing. But we even see it here in our passage when when God is speaking to Noah and his sons and establishing the covenant that we read about in chapter 9, that he assumes that there will be people who will do the wrong thing and will take life, will murder people. And that there will be a consequence for that. Sin is now part of the creation. There's nothing that can be easily done about it. And as we know, as we've got to the end of the Bible, it's only through Jesus that sin is finally dealt with. But what we see here, not just that sin is part of the picture, but that God is a God who does not like sin, who in fact hates sin, abhors sin. God is a God who judges sin. So when God sees that the earth is corrupt and the people are full of violence, he can't ignore it. He has to deal with it. He has to punish it. And so we have this flood with the terrible, tragic consequences for all of rebellious humanity. Only one person is, you know, right in God's eyes and is able to, you know, be forgiven the sin and be kind of spared that judgment. And that's a kind of prototype, you know, a kind of early kind of clue into how God is going to choose one person through whom forgiveness and a new hope for God's people is going to come. That person, of course, will be Jesus. But God is a God who judges sin. He cannot leave it unpunished. He might delay, but he cannot leave it unpunished. But we also see loud and clear, if you can see something loud and clear, what we see here is that God is a God of mercy. He's not just a God of judgment on sin, as though that's a bad thing. It is, in fact, a good thing, because deep down, we all want wrong to be made right, and we want wrong to be punished. God is a God who punishes sin, but he's also a God who is full of mercy, who loves mercy and loves to show mercy. And so we see this in his rescue plan here for Noah. God is the one who comes up with the plan. He doesn't just say, there's going to be a flood, deal with it, Noah. He says, there's going to be a flood, so build yourself an ark of cypress wood and make rooms in it and make the space for your family and for all the animals. God is the one who delights in mercy, and who also promises not to send a flood like this again, which may seem strange as the rain beats down on the roof and against the windows here in the hall, but he will not send a flood like this to cover the world. Well, that reminds me, this reset of creation I mentioned before was a visual thing, because at the very beginning, there was just water covering the earth before it you know, the land got formed and everything like that. That's part of the reason God does it by a flood now. He's resetting creation. Sorry, that's a digression. Back to where we're up to. God is a God of mercy, and so he chooses Noah and his family to be the ones through whom mercy will be shown to humanity, and humanity can start again. And what we also see here is that God is a God of promise and covenant. A covenant is like a treaty between two parties or between a ruler and his people. And God is a God who makes a covenant here with Noah and his descendants. And he makes a promise. First of all, we see God promising to save Noah through building the ark. And he's also a God who promises not to send a flood again, and that he'll remind people of that promise through putting the rainbow in the sky. And, you know, that the relationship of humanity with the creation is still the same, even though, you know, things aren't as good as they were in the garden, that humanity is above, you know, the animals and the plants and that sort of thing. God is a God of promise and covenant, a God who always keeps his promises. And it's great to see that from the outset in the Bible. It's not just something that comes along later on. And what we also see in this great story is the role of faith. Because Noah is a great person of faith. We see his great faith in hearing this command of God to build an ark, you know, in the middle of nowhere, far from the sea. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen boats up on land. There's that one down near Manildra in Bowland area, that strange big boat that's kind of up always on the land. And I remember as a kid, there was a particular road we could drive on where there was this one big boat that was being built for years and years and years, just in someone's field by their house. And it always looks odd seeing a boat on the land with, you know, no water around it. Here we have Noah, who went to all the effort of obeying God and building this ark and gathering the food. So we see his faith demonstrated there. And we also see his faith in the way he waits, and his family are waiting for the flood to be over. It would have been quite a challenge, I think, being on that ark in those cramped circumstances, with only that view out the top window, without even being able to see whether there was land poking up, just kind of waiting, waiting, waiting for the flood to subside as God had promised. And, you know, you might have found, you know, isolation, lockdown, very difficult, especially if there were kids home doing online learning. But imagine waiting, waiting, waiting for all that time, waiting for those floods to subside. It showed great faith in God and his promises that they did that. I mean, on one level, I guess they didn't have a choice, but his faith in God was such that when the flood subsided, the first thing he did was to, you know, make a sacrifice thanking God for his mercy. So we also see in this story the wonderful example of Noah in responding to God with obedience. Firstly, in the way he lived his life righteously, but also in these very concrete acts of building the ark and getting on with things afterwards. So these are these great truths about God and him, who he is, what he's like, and how he deals with the world, how he deals with humanity, how he promises to rescue humanity from sin. These great truths that are in this very familiar story about Noah. What do we do with this? What do we do with these truths? What do we take away? How can they actually impact on our life today? There's some really, really helpful things that we can actually learn from, draw on, and put into practice. The first of all comes from that reminder that God is a God who hates sin. Not sinners, but sin. God is a God who cannot stand it. God is a just God who must deal with it, must judge it, must punish it. It would actually be wrong of God to ignore sin, to not deal with it. And because we've learned this, or been reminded of it here in Genesis 6 to 9, we are reminded that we should take sin seriously too in our own lives. We shouldn't trivialize it or ignore it or think it doesn't matter, encourage it. We should take sin seriously. We should get rid of it in our lives. We should avoid it where we can. And we should walk righteously with God. Now, Noah wasn't perfect. He wasn't sinless. But he lived his life seeking to obey God and making, you know, the appropriate changes, as you see in the story of Noah after the passages we read today, making the appropriate changes in his life when he does stuff. And that's what being righteous and walking with God, walking righteously with God, means in the Bible. Of course, none of us are sinless or perfect. But we can choose to obey God and try our best to do that. But the other great truth we learn here is to trust in God's promises as we walk in faith and obedience. I mean, that's what faith is. It's trust. Trust in a promise, trust in a person, the person making the promise. We trust the promises of God, and so we respond with obedience. And of course, the great promises that Noah received here are nothing to the promises we've received in Jesus. If we believe that he is God's Son who died for us on the cross, and if we believe that he came back to life on the third day, then we will be forgiven because sin has been dealt with. We will live forever with God because death has been defeated. Those are the promises that our Christian faith depends on. We can learn from the example of Noah. As we live our lives seeing sin abound around us, going through difficult times, dealing with heartache and sorrow, struggling with sin in our own life, whatever it might be, we can respond by trusting in those promises, letting our hope of forgiveness and life forever guide us and shape us and lead us on as we walk in righteousness, as we try to live out our faith in obedience. And we can bask in God's mercy. Trusting in these promises means we need not fear his judgment on our sin and on the sin of the world. We will not suffer the same fate. Obviously, we won't, you know, be punished, judged with flood. But the Bible makes it clear that God is going to judge sin. He is going to deal with it once and for all, that there'll be another situation, a worse situation, the one we see in Genesis 6 and 7 and 8 and 9. But there is a way out. It's not an ark, a boat made of wood. It's a cross made of wood that Jesus died on for us. And so we should bask in that mercy, be free of guilt and shame, and get on with living our lives God's way. See, it's funny how from these very familiar, maybe you even think of, you know, these stories as kids' stories, Sunday school stories, these really deep and profound truths about God can be found. I hope that's been encouraging for you today, and I want to encourage you to continue thinking about this great God who acts in our lives through his Son Jesus and his Holy Spirit. And I pray that you too will respond to this great God in faith and obedience. In fact, I'm going to pray that now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your abundant love for us, your guiding hand, your law, your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus to die for us and come back to life. Thank you that all we need to do is trust in him and show faith to be saved. That there's no boxes to tick, no rules to follow, no achievements to list. It's all faith in your promises. We thank you for that, Lord, and ask that we would respond in faith and get on with living righteous lives, obeying you. We pray all this in your Son's great name. Amen.
Well, thanks, John. Last week we reminded that we have all sinned, we've all turned our back on God in our own way. We all also recognise the world of Noah's day, don't we, where everybody's thought was only evil all of the time, and that each of us play our part in that. That's one of the reasons why when Christians gather together, they confess their sins. They want to remind each other that we all fail, we all fall short of what God wants from us, and we need to come to him to receive the forgiveness that he offers. So I wonder if you would join with me as we pray this prayer of confession together. After that, Graham Fairburn is going to lead us in prayer. But let's pray. Most merciful God, we humbly admit that we need your help. We confess that we have wandered from your way. We have done wrong, and we have failed to do what is right. You alone can save us. Have mercy on us. Wipe out our sins and teach us to forgive others. Bring forth in us the fruit of the Spirit, that we may live as disciples of Christ. This we ask in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. God showed his grace by rescuing Noah, and grace is still available to everyone who asks for it. In Romans 3, verse 23, we read, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus." And so later in chapter 8, we read, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, and nothing in all of creation can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." So let's come before God in confidence and pray together.
Well, good morning. I'm Graham Fairbairn, and it's my privilege this morning to lead you in prayer. I want to start off with just a few verses from Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place. What is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with glory and honour. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Please join with me in prayer. Almighty God, creator of the heavens and the earth, we come to you today, not just as the one who made us and sustains us, but as our loving Heavenly Father, who cares deeply about every one of us, about our lives, about our hopes and fears, and about our world, its troubles and its hopes. Father, we thank you for this great privilege of prayer, of being able to come into your presence because of what you have done for us in the death and resurrection of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that you have redeemed us through him and adopted us as brothers and sisters in Christ, sharing all the blessings of life eternal with him. We thank you for your promises which sustain our hope as we live our lives in this world full of conflict and trouble. Lord, we've heard from the book of Genesis how the universe is the product of your powerful, creative word, how you've made humanity in your image and given us the privilege and responsibility of caring for this world under your authority. We've seen how we've been alienated from you and from one another through our sin and rebellion. And yet, you reach out in grace, time and time again, to rescue us and to restore us to fellowship with you. You brought hope through Noah, who found favour with you. He was a righteous man, a man who walked with you. You blessed him and gave humanity a fresh start through him and his family. You have blessed us in a far greater way through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, giving us forgiveness for the past, strength for the present, and hope for the future, the guarantee of life forever with you. May we never take these blessings for granted. Help us to be people who, like Noah and Enoch before him, walk with you each day. We pray today for our world. We pray for world leaders, for those with great power and the resources that they will use them not simply for the welfare of their own people, but to meet the needs of all those whose lives and livelihood are threatened by war and conflict, by disease and natural disasters. We remember today particularly the people of Beirut, Lebanon, for those who were injured or lost loved ones in the explosion there this week. We pray for a stable and effective government in Lebanon which is facing so many challenges at this time. We pray for the peaceful resolution of the wars and conflicts in many places in our world. We remember the aid agencies that are working to bring relief and hope in dangerous and difficult situations. We thank you for the work of Anglican Aid and ask that its resources will be used to bring the hope of the gospel to a lost world. We pray for our own nation, for the Prime Minister, and for the premiers and chief ministers of each state and territory, that as they work together to address the challenges we face in Australia, that they will have wisdom and good advice to make good decisions in relation to the threats of the coronavirus pandemic. We ask particularly that the issues facing the provision of aged care will be dealt with in ways which answer the needs and concerns of those in aged care and their families. We pray for medical and hospital workers as they care for those who have contracted the virus, and for the police and ADF personnel in their role in protecting our community from the spread of the virus. We remember all those responsible for the administration of the resources of our land and for our own representatives in federal, state and local government. Give them strength and wisdom to govern well, to resist the pressures of corrupting influences. We bring you today also the needs of Christian ministry in our own community. We thank you for Steve and Lorna, for John and Fiona, for Kaz, for Susan, for Graham and for their families. We pray for them as they minister to us. We pray for the work with our children and youth. We thank you for the opportunities to reach out through SRE and schools, through youth and children's groups. We ask that through these ministries, many will come to know the Lord Jesus and grow in their love for him, and in their desire to live their lives for him. We thank you also that we can share in ministry around the world through prayer and support for missionary work. We pray for the Church Missionary Society, remembering particularly Simon and Jessica Cowell with Lydia, Emma and Timothy. We thank you for their safe arrival back in Italy to recommence their work there. We pray for Andrew and Liz Glover in Cambodia and for the ministry in Phnom Penh. We pray for the work of BCA in remote Australia. Please provide the personnel and resources for continuing ministry in the outback, particularly in places where communities are struggling with the effects of drought. We pray for James and Brittany Damon that they will find many open doors for the gospel in Mudgee. Today we also remember those in special need in our own community, for those living with the challenges of age or illness, and for those who care for them. We pray for those who are mourning the loss of loved ones and for those facing the issues of retirement or unemployment. We also bring to you those dealing with family breakdown and domestic violence. Lord, help us to become more aware of the needs of our neighbours, to find ways to give them support and hope. Most of all, we pray that we, your people, will be light shining in this dark world, radiating the hope of the gospel, of life and peace through the Lord Jesus. We pray all this in his name, as we pray the prayer that he taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Well, thanks so much, Graham, and thanks all of you for joining us today. We've almost come to the end of our service, but before we do, there are a couple of things I want to bring to your attention. And the first one is to do with pastoral care. We've all been made very much aware in recent days, haven't we, of the pain and suffering that there is in our world, and how difficult it is for us to cope with those things. And so we as a staff have recognised how difficult it is for us to care for one another. And so in the coming weeks, we're going to provide a number of opportunities to help us to be more effective in our care for one another. The first opportunity is going to be on Sunday the 6th of September. We'll be we'll have a break in our Genesis series, and we'll be looking during that week about how we might encourage one another, how we can lift up and support one another. In the weeks after that, we're going to be conducting a seminar, an online seminar, for which all people will be welcome from within the church and from outside the church, where we'll be having some clinical psychologists, some GPs, and some other experts in the field to talk about anxiety and depression and how we can cope, particularly in this time of stress that COVID-19 is bringing upon us. We also have a number of people in our congregation who have done mental health first aid training. We're hoping to use some of the expertise that they have gathered to help all of us within the congregation to care for each other. So keep an eye and an ear out for those things. Also, I want to let you know about some of the things that are happening in Quebec. But rather than myself telling you, Wiki's going to tell you a little bit of what's happening in Quebec. And after he shares with us, we're going to sing our final song, Jesus Messiah.
Hello, it's Wiki here with an update for you on SRE at Kayama High. It's week one, term three, and I'm back at school for another exciting term of scripture teaching, even in this COVID-19 season. I was able to recommence teaching in week five of term two after the department gave exceptions to schools with timetabled SRE teachers to return. It was great to see the students after about 6 weeks of no face-to-face interaction. Indeed, what a great joy. And one of my highlights last term was creating the space for students to share their COVID stories, how they are coping with it all. And it was really encouraging to hear some of the students share how they find their hope and how their anchor is in Jesus through this season of uncertainty. We also resumed the Bible Project, our ISCF lunchtime group, and it was really great to be able to get that started back up in term two last term, and we are continuing again this term with the same. My observation from last term is that there is a great sense of fear of the unknown, and again a great sense of hopelessness as well among some of the students and staff. And with the unfortunate loss of one of the students to suicide over the school holidays, the desperation for light at the end of the tunnel is very, very evident. So please pray for the KHS community that people may find comfort and refuge in our good God. And also please pray for me that God will give me discernment and wisdom in the conversations I have with the students and teachers in the coming weeks. It's going to be very, very hard for a lot of people. And I just want to say thank you for your continued support in prayers, financial giving, and all of your lovely encouragements that I've been getting over the last few months. And thanks for taking your time to listen to this update. God bless you. Bye.
God has been gracious to us, and he calls us to share that grace with each other. So let's finish off our service by saying together the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. See you next time.